Ladies and gentlemen, this is Annie Morales, and thank you for joining me to episode 2, season 2 of Gendom Sessions Live podcast. Hope everyone's having a good day, a good night, good evening, or whatever time zone you're listening on this from. So I'm happy to announce that my guest today is Robert A. Kazi. Robert, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Andy. It's great to be here.
Awesome. So how are you, man?
I'm doing well. I'm doing well. Can't complain. You know, this for us has been a really pivotal year for writers in particular, because we've been given the gift of time to create. So that's what I'm remembering in the midst of all this craziness.
Yeah, no, I hear you on that. I think with this craziness, at least from my life, I felt like it's shown me my own true colors, I guess, where I was able to see what it is and actually write about it, if that makes sense.
Yes, makes total sense.
So we'll just get right to the first question, I guess, is like, so how did this all start for you as far as writing? Like, was it something you did recently? Was it something you did your entire life? Did somebody inspire you to write? Like, how does this all start for you?
Well, I started a really long time ago. I can remember back in fifth grade, really feeling like I was a writer in some sort of way, in a fifth grade mind, because we did a lot of creative writing that year and I began to win some prizes for it. And so I knew it was something that I enjoyed, and I always enjoyed books and reading. And then it wasn't until I was in junior high school and I had a teacher for English who told me I was a writer and said that I needed to keep writing and I should keep a journal. So I started writing in a journal when I was 14, and I still write in a journal. So my entire life is written down. So I've always been a writer. However, I didn't start putting my works out there publicly until 2011. I started to enter some poetry contests and got published in some compilation books because of the contest. And then my debut book, Tide Pool Awards, was released in 2013. So I was relatively late to the game, so to speak, because I was in my 50s when my first book was released. So it took me a lot of years to write beyond the confines of my journal and be brave enough to share them.
But you're never too young or never too old to like do something like that. You know what I'm saying? Like,
absolutely,
at the end of the day,
not.
You're still young at heart no matter what.
Yeah.
And it's good. That's awesome, though. I had a similar experience where, like, when I was in I started writing in junior high school, and I don't know what it was exactly, but for me, it was like I just started writing. I know my dad used to write a lot, and somehow it just transferred on me, and I just started writing. And I've shown my work to certain teachers, and they're like, yo, keep writing as well. Definitely. So how did it feel to, like, when you first, that first accomplishment, the poetry contest? Tell me about it.
Well, it was a surprise to me because I just sort of blindly sent in some poems to various contests. And then when I made it to semifinal round, it guaranteed you publication. They guaranteed you publication in their compilation. So I was just very excited about that. I wasn't expecting anything. And like yourself, I mean, my mom was a writer, and so I grew up around writing, and my mom had a very successful weekly column in the local newspaper that had a big cult following, and she was famous in our area of New Jersey, and she was even published in the New York Times a few times just by blindly sending in articles, which is pretty amazing. So my mom was an incredible writer, so I had that already. But it felt incredible to finally see my words in print. And then I started to believe more and more that maybe there was something to this. And I started sharing more online, on Facebook. And that was how I got my first publishing deal, because my publisher, really small independent publisher, but he saw one of my poems that I'd written after Hurricane Sandy on Facebook. And he was like a friend of a friend on Facebook. That's how he was able to see the post. And he contacted me and said, you know, I really love this poem. Do you have others? Have you ever thought about putting together a book? Because I'd be interested in reading more. And I kind of laughed and I said, well, I have so many things that I can send you. You could probably wallpaper your entire house with my poetry.
Wow. So the you know, so to the casual listener, right?
Yeah.
Explain to them. I don't know if this happens for you, but I know it happens to a lot of people. How difficult is it to get your work out there?
It's not difficult at all, I don't think, especially now, because you've got Instagram. We're both fixtures on Instagram, and you can put your work out there. Instagram is very welcoming to artists, and you could do it via Facebook. You could do it on a blog. I think it's much easier to get your work out now than when I was in my 20s, because there was no internet. There wasn't anything. You had to enter contests, you know, and that was really the only way to get your work out. Now you can have a YouTube channel. And actually, my whole jump from my journal to outside my journal began with the early days of YouTube, because I had a YouTube channel and I used to talk about the singers and songwriters I had come across on YouTube, the undiscovered ones. And I used to do these videos kind of talking about their songs, because music is a huge influence on me too. And I'm a huge music lover. And
me too.
So I was doing that. And then I started to just lately start sharing my poetry with a very select audience. I used to do private videos and send it out to about 20 of my friends in this circle of other artists, and all these friendships that I'd made on YouTube. And they all were encouraging me to start posting publicly. So, and then I started posting publicly. And ironically, in the five books that I have so far, three of the forewords were written by my YouTube friends from those early days of 2005-ish. And so it's a testament to how you can bond with other artists on these platforms. So I think it's relatively easy now. I think you need a lot of luck on your side, though. The right person needs to see your work in order to get the really big deals. But if you're consistent about how you write and how you post, and if you're authentic, then I think the sky's the limit.
I agree with that, definitely. And I was gonna say too, where to add on to your point is not just putting yourself out there, but engaging, because I think mm-hmm. engaging with your audience and engaging yes. with people that comment on your stuff, even if they like it, hey, thank you for the like. What you think of it, you know, but that's a good way to engage. And I think for me, that's definitely true, because I was able to engage with other poets and other, you know, people just like yourself. Yeah. You know, we can, and the fact that we're, you know what it's too, because it's like with this platform, this inspired me to want to do a podcast. I had a first season when I had a team. And then when I decided, you know, I'm going to bring it back with this, I'll do it myself, because I don't have a community page team anymore. It's just, you know what? I'll just do it my way, and that's it.
Yeah.
And now you and I, here we are talking, you know, and it's just how crazy it is, because, you know, I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York, and I live in Bayonne, New Jersey, and you're in Jersey. Yes. It's so crazy, like, how, like, it's such a big world, but really, social media makes the world so small.
Yes, it does. You know, and a lot of my poetry is so New York-based, because I spent a lot of time in the city, because I grew up in Westfield, and we were just a train ride out of the city. And I've lived elsewhere, but when I moved back to New Jersey in 96, one of the biggest reasons I moved back was I missed New York City. I missed it, because there's no city like New York in the entire world. And I needed that back. But readers will find New York all over my poetry. And speaking of, you know, the followers and the readers, I love my audience, because many of them have been with me since the first book, and they're still with me.
Nice.
And the other interesting thing about my readers is that I was shocked after the first book, and we got the demographics back from the sale and everything, that my readers are 18 to 34 is like the main demographic. And I'm much older than that. And I found that so interesting. And that's still true to this day, that my readers are a lot younger than I am. And
but isn't that beautiful, though?
It is. Like, I love it. I absolutely love it, because there's such a wonderful energy from people that age, and their view of the world I love. And, you know, I assembled an anthology this year, and everybody is younger than I am in the anthology. And many of them are people in their 20s getting ready to launch their debut books. And It was such an incredible experience to assemble them all, and they didn't know one another. I was the only common denominator. I reached out to people that I admired. I'd been familiar with their work, a little bit familiar with them as people, but not a whole lot, and just sort of went with my gut. So, you know, I think getting back to, you know, engaging and everything, I'm very, 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 I spend a lot of time communicating with the readers. I'm easy to get in touch with. They can message me, they could email me, and I love getting messages from them. And I love hearing what they love, what they don't love, everything in between. And they're very honest with me, and I'm very honest with them. So I really love the relationship.
That's amazing. That's definitely beautiful. And I was going to ask also, how much does that mean to you? Like, how important is that?
It's everything. It's absolutely everything, because, you know, I've had some luck, you know, I've won some book awards and things like that, but none of them compare to the messages I get from readers. If I get a message from a reader saying that a poem of mine changed their life, or it touched them a certain way, or they reminded them of something they'd long forgotten, then that means everything. That means so much more to me than anything else.
And that's beautiful, because again, it's like, yeah, I could write something. Okay, cool, you're liking, that's great. But the fact that you're able to leave a lasting impact, yes, that it's like when they look back, they're like, yeah, I remember that guy.
Yes.
Even when I commented him on his page, he came back and he commented back. We engaged. But because it's easy to leave behind some writing, but I believe in the power of legacy. When you leave something like that behind, mm-hmm, they'll remember you not just for your writing, but for your honesty, for your,
yes,
for your, you know, for your humbleness, your for everything that you stand for, you know. And the fact that people can remember you by not just that one thing, but by a whole bunch of,
yes,
things, you know. And that's a very beautiful thing. And I can't say that a lot of people these days have that, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's artists, you know, I mean, artists could be, you know, whether it's acting or whatever, you know, because I'll give an example, and it sucks, but I'll give an example of this. This one poet, Elise Cowan, she was one of the people of the Beat Generation, yes, era, but a lot of people don't remember her. A lot of people don't really know who she is, because she never was given the opportunity to really put her work out there due to Allen Ginsberg. And, you know, it's just so many factors. But it wasn't until years later, I think his name was Leo Skirt,
mm-hmm,
he finally put her work out there. But like, oh, how come we never knew that? But see, but the writings were so good, but we don't know a lot about,
yeah,
her. Because unfortunately, she completed suicide, unfortunately, mm-hmm, due to like her environment and stuff like that. But it just comes to show, like, because as it goes back to what I'm saying, like, you could do all this, but then, oh, this is awesome, but I don't know who she is. We don't know a lot about,
yeah,
her because of the unfortunate circumstances, you know. So the only legacy we probably know her for is her poetry, but we don't know how much of an impact it had,
right,
in that generation.
Right.
So, you know, I guess same thing goes here. In your case, I believe even after I'm long gone, we're all long gone, but this is something to look back at and say, wow, like, but I remember this guy. Mm-hmm. I remember this guy did this and he did that, you know. He was so kind and all this other stuff, you know. So with all that being said, if you want to read a piece,
sure,
you know, give the audience an example of how,
sure,
you write.
I'd love to. And before I do that, though, I just wanted to comment on what you just said, because legacy is huge. And I can't think of anything more beautiful than leaving behind your written words. And that's one of the things we get to do as writers, is we get to leave that behind. And with the hopes that somebody will pick up something that we've written, one of our books, or see a poem that we wrote and be affected 100 years from now. And I can't think of anything more beautiful than that. And I absolutely, again, love how intimate my relationship is with my readers, because I wouldn't want it any other way, because I know so many of them by first name. They've been at my book signings. I've become friends with some of them, and it's a really cool, intimate relationship. And I've gotten so much better because of them. Because they weigh in, and they're not afraid to weigh in on everything, you know. And I love that.
One thing I was going to say too, it's funny. I guess I'm saying it's funny. Sometimes it's funny. It's interesting. It's I guess it's interesting in a beautiful way that it's like I look at younger generations because I'm 35. Yeah. You know, so I'm still growing. I guess as a man.
Of course. I remember 35. 35 was a great time. I loved my 30s.
And I gotta say what was I gonna? Oh yeah. So it's interesting because I've met so many people in the Instagram poetry community, and it's so interesting to me how a lot of the people that are younger than myself has had it just as bad as me, or they had it worse than me. But the fact that I can relate in some way that we could talk about that, because when I was growing up, you know, if I was telling like the stuff we're talking about now, there was no way that someone older than me when I was like 20 or 19 or whatever, I couldn't have these conversations with someone older than me, like say from my father or teachers and that were older than me. Anyone that was around my dad's age, you know, when I was growing up, and we couldn't have conversations like that. We couldn't talk about, you know, hey, the birds and the bees, and we couldn't talk about, you know, hey, I'm dealing with depression, like, be there for me type thing. Like, you know, all the mental health stuff that now people are more open to. I couldn't talk about that kind of stuff with my family, you know, or anyone I knew that was older than I was. And it's just good to know that, okay, finally, at least that aspect has changed so much, you know, and just seeing it through people's writings. Like, I'll give you an example of a few poets I met. They're only 15, 16 years old, but they're writing like they're 20, 30 years old. I'm like, wait, you're only 15? Oh my God. Like, you know, because I was always told, oh, well, you're too young, you'll never understand. And be quiet, you know, because I've been told no, I've been told what to do, I've been put down, I've been shut down, all this other stuff. And it's good to know that, okay, at least the older generation don't look at the younger generation like as if, oh, you're still young, you don't know. Yeah, like that's changing. Definitely. And that's changed a
definitely
lot.
Definitely, like that, the generation coming up now, they're the ones who give me the hope, because no other generation has gotten it right. My generation didn't get it right, you know, and I'm 57 years old. And I can look at the generation coming up now, and they're passionate, they're unified, they're smart, they're energetic. And I'm putting everything, all my hope in them to get things changed.
And that's beautiful, because like, think about it. Imagine if we were doing this years earlier, let's say early 2000s, they would think we were pedophiles or something, you know, like that's how it was. That's how the mind was back then. Oh, you're 50. Why are you talking to my child? He's only 17. You know, like they always get the wrong idea. And I feel like the platform today has given us the opportunity to grow. Because I grew up around 1950s Puerto Ricans. Like my father was straight up, you know, like the campos, like those people, you know, back in those days, and very old school. Like it's just what it was. He was basically black and white. So the fact that he was always the one telling me, you know, and I know it wasn't out of disrespect or anything like that. It's just, you know, I didn't understand at the time, but you know, the fact that again, like I could look back at that. Okay, that's amazing that can change, but like, the whole aspect of wow, we're able to express in that such profound way, you know, and it's like, oh, and like you said about generations, that's true. Because even, I mean, I'm 35. I don't know if I'm considered a type of generation, but I'll say when I was growing up, people around my age, I don't think got it right either until after the fact. Because the kids today, right? The majority of them that are there, their parents are around our age range, really. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know kids, like, I know people who have kids that are, like, 17, 18 years old right now, but, like, that, like, and they will talk about the life experience their parents have, but the fact that they're able to understand. But back when I was growing up, I can tell you my father's life story, but he'll probably look at me like, you know, God rest his soul. Oh, well, you know, I mean, it wasn't, you know, like, they'll try to change it up so they'll make them feel a certain type of way, but now it's different. It's more open, it's more raw, and that's such a beautiful thing, you know?
It is. Totally. Totally is. All right, so you'd like me to read a poem? Okay.
Yes.
Here we go. This is from the anthology that I assembled that I mentioned before. It's called Perspective to Pen, and we are donating 100% of the proceeds to Amnesty International since we're a worldwide group of poets. So that's one cool thing about this anthology. And this is a poem from the anthology that's in my chapter called The Sound Heard Above the City. It takes a moment for you to look up from the book you are reading. You are seated at a small stained glass table in this intimate outdoor cafe. An array of emotion fills your face before you stand up with your inherent grace. You still have a swimmer's build, but your eyes are not as blue. They seem to have faded gently like a memory. Your hair is no longer tousled and bleached from the sun. It has matured into a darker, more conservative looking blonde. When you come to me, we embrace. A grimace of happiness cracks my mouth as a veil of your aroma envelops me, bringing back the feeling, not just the memory, of the years we spent together. Inside this embrace, I can feel the sand of Folly Beach and smell the ocean air and remember what it was like to be so completely loved by you. But once you pull away, I hear my heart crack above the sounds of the city.
Wow. I love that. I love the imagery with that. Oh my goodness. Can you read that line about the smell of the ocean? Yes.
Inside this embrace, I can feel the sand of Folly Beach and smell the ocean air and remember what it was like to be so completely loved by you. But once you pull away, I hear my heart crack above the sounds of the city.
I love that. Like, talk to me about that piece. Like, what inspired the piece? And were you at a place like
New York City vibes. So this was New York City. And I fell in love when I was in my early 20s. And my first love and I, we were together all through our 20s. So 10 years. And the only reason we broke up was both of our careers were taking off. I'm in the hotel business. I've been in the hotel business for 30 plus years. So I'm a hotel guy. And my career was taking me in one direction and his career was taking him in another direction and neither one of us wanted the other one to compromise. And so we decided that we'd try to stay together, but then the long distance thing, after about a month, we just said, this isn't fair to either one of us. So we ended things. And then this was written about 3 years later, the first time I'd seen him in person after we had broken up and he had come up to New York. And so this was that whole scene. And this is exactly how it felt.
Wow.
And yeah, so this is a real, real experience. And the thing about my poetry is that I don't embellish because I kept a journal. This is why I'm so insistent when I get the ear of a young writer that they need to journal and they need to write down their life because that's where you can draw the greatest inspiration from your own experiences. And you want those intimate details of everything. And I was able to go back to my journal entry and remember that it was a stained glass table and all these little tiny details, which are lovely to put into the poem to make the imagery nice and crisp for the reader, because I want the reader to feel like they're there with me.
Wow.
So that's where that came from.
That's awesome, man. It really is. And it's funny because as you're reading that, I was thinking about, because, you know, I'm originally from New York myself. And because I'll say this, the atmosphere of New York compared to like your time and my, like, you know, me growing up, it's changed a lot, actually. It's not, I feel like the old New York has long gone and this is the new New York. And I used to go to this pier on, I don't know if you're familiar with this part of Brooklyn, Williamsburg, Bedford Avenue and North 7. There's like a pier. If you go up North 7 to, I think, White Street or something like that, there's like a whole pier thing. And I remember when it first opened up because me and a friend of mine went to a concert there. They did, they had, I think it was 2009, I believe. And I remember, this is when Four Loko, the beer first came to New York. I think originally this was from Florida or something like that. And I remember going to a concert. They were doing these series of concerts. Stone Temple Pilots just happened to be there. And I actually remember going to this concert. But it's just so crazy when I first came in, you know, just going to that area, it's like, wow, this is so beautiful. I remember that night too, after I was done, I said, let me go to the pier and just hang out there. And I was just so in love with the city view of Manhattan. Yeah. Like, you could see it so wide open like that. But it's so crazy because when I was growing up, that area was vacancy. It was just industrial. Like, you couldn't even walk in that area.
Yeah.
And it's so crazy how it's changed so dramatically. Yeah. You know, now, and we talk about New York, like, what actually was it about New York that you fell in love with? I mean, I guess for me, because I've always lived in New York, and then I moved in 2008 to New Jersey now. I'm homesick to a point where, okay, like I'll go visit, but I know I would never live there again. I never want to live in New York again because of the chaos I went through. But because there's a lot of things that I still love about New York, even though it's like a love-hate relationship.
Yeah,
it does.
You know, for me, New York just has a certain energy. Like, I feel very inspired when I'm in New York. I feel wildly creative. I feel like there's a story around every corner. I don't know. It's just there's so much going on, and I just need to be there. And for all the artistic stuff, for all the performing arts, I mean, for everything, and for the sports, because I'm a big sports fan too, and for the concerts, and I don't know, it's like it has everything, and I just always feel really energized in the city, and I love the city, and I've never lived there. I did go to NYU for grad school. So I was in and out of the city every day while I was at NYU. And that was probably the most time I spent. But I grew up going into the city with my family. We always went in to see shows, just to go in to have dinner. We used to go into, I'm half Italian, so we used to go into Little Italy quite a bit. And I loved all that. We used to go in for San Gennaro. So.
Me too. San Gennaro is no joke.
For those of you who don't know, the San Gennaro Festival, you eat your way from one end of the block to the other, and it's amazing. It's so amazing. And
yes, that's one of those places you got to fast the night before. Make sure you make
and then you're full like for 2 days because, you know, I'm eating all the zapples and you know, all the fried dough, you know. The Zeppoli and all that, you know, I mean, the sausage and the meatballs and it's just overload. And so I love all that about New York, you know, and it's funny because the piece I just read to you, our mutual friend Hiro, that's one of his favorites of mine. Like, he loves that. And we became friends because he'd seen some of my pieces because we have a mutual poet friend. And he was like, okay, he has a lot of New York in his poetry. I need to talk to this guy. And so I have New York to thank for my friendship now, my close friendship with Hiro. So New York keeps giving to me. New York keeps giving to me.
yes, definitely. I remember a while back when the pandemic first started, I would say maybe 2 months in, I remember I did like a live where I was just exploring because I haven't been in New York in such a long time. It's, you know, because the reason why I would go is to see my mother because my mom still lives in Brooklyn, even though I'm trying to like, my mom, get out of this public housing, please. Like, but you know, it is what it is. And as I'm walking, say, all right, let me walk around New York and then I say, you know, let me go to Manhattan and I'll walk from Manhattan to Brooklyn because my mom still lives in Williamsburg. So I said, I'll walk. It's a good walk. I needed to walk that day. And I remember doing a live, but like just looking around, like, wow, how so much has changed since this thing happened, right? Because everything was shut down. Even churches were shut down at that time. And I'm just like, wait, this is not the same New York. Like when I walked through because I took the bus, I think, from Hoboken to Times Square. That's why I took the 126 bus. I said, I'll walk through it. It was a nice day. And I think my wife was at her mom's house at the time. I said, you know, let me walk. And I remember just walking around, like, just straight. So I went up the numbers, down the numbers. So I went from 8th Avenue over to 5th Avenue. Because I used to work at 5th Avenue by the Trump Tower. Okay. I used to work across the street, actually, before I started working at my previous job. And as I'm, you know, walking, it's so crazy. Like, it's not the same, right? Because even though there was people, there was so little people. Yeah. I'm like, wait, Times Square was never like this. Fifth Avenue was never like this. Like, as I'm going down the numbers, I'm like, I'm just so, like, in awe, as in, like, oh, my God, I can't believe this happened. But in such, I was just mesmerized how civilization changed from that time. Because Times Square, if you're from New York, you know Times Square is not an easy place to walk around. And the fact that I was able to stretch my balls and like stretch my arms and I was able to just walk, and I'm like, oh my God. Like,
yeah, and that never was the case before. Never. No matter what time of day you were in Times Square.
No way.
Right?
You could be there at 3 in the morning, there was still people. Because I used to work. I did security in Times Square too. I used to work at Broadway because I know Broadway and 7, they intertwine. Once you hit like the mid 40s, and that area, I could leave at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning from work sometimes, and there were still people hanging out. I was like, yo, it wasn't as crowded, but it was still crowded, you know, for that time of night. I'm just like, oh my God, like, what's going on here? And one thing I will give to New York, and I noticed that, I'm not saying that Jersey doesn't have, but I think New York is very well known for this. Every block you go to is a different civilization. You go to Fifth Avenue, it's a different civilization. You go to Eighth Avenue, it's a whole different thing.
Multiple vibes.
And then you go, yes, because Fifth Avenue, if you go up the 50s, all bougie. It's all luxury retail. But then once you hit like 40s and down, it's different, right? Because you either get a hipster vibe, a ghetto vibe, or you get a little bit of both worlds. Because my wife, too, was also in the hotel business herself. She used to work at different hotels. She worked at the Radisson, which is on by Herald Square. She worked at the DoubleTree. She's worked at the Evelyn Hotel, which was by the Sex Museum, and that's a different civilization itself too. Because I'm like, wait, what? Because I never went straight down Fifth Avenue until she started working. I said, let me walk straight down, see what's going on. And every block, it was always changing. But I like the fact that it doesn't just change instantly. It's like it gradually changes with the streets. And it's like, I don't know if I can get that anywhere else. Because if I go to Hoboken,
it's the same.
It's like, it's nothing really changes. Yeah. And it's interesting because I'm like, maybe one or two things are slightly different, but for the most part, it's exactly the same thing. And I'm just like, okay.
That's so true. And that's why there's no city like New York. I'm sorry. There isn't.
Yes. Yeah, because I've been to Chicago too. It's like I feel like it's a poorer version of New York. It's like they're trying to be
not even close.
They just can't.
I'm sorry, it's not even close. They don't know how to do their pizza is ridiculous. I can't. As an Italian, I can't.
Oh my God.
I can't.
Oh my goodness. Speaking of pizza, I went to a pizza shop with one of my friends, right? And I kid you not, I'm eating pizza like I normally eat pizza, and they look at me like, I think I went to Uno's over there or something like that. And they had the deep dish pizza. They actually had like regular slices. So I said, let me just get a regular slice at the time because I wasn't that hungry. Typically, I would get a deep dish, I would get a whole bunch of stuff. And I'm eating the pizza like I normally be, and they're looking at me like I'm weird. I'm like, why is everyone looking at me weird? Like, and then the waiter's like, oh, I take it you're not from here. I'm like, wait, what? Like, you're from New York, right? I'm like, wait, what? Like, how do you know I'm from New York? Oh, because we don't eat pizza like this. I'm like, what? Like, it was just so weird.
It's bizarre.
I've never experienced this. I'm saying, hey, bizarre. I hope you enjoy your food.
It's bizarre. You know, like, I used to work for Hyatt Hotels, and our corporate office was in Chicago. And so, I had some experience with Chicago dining, and I couldn't do the Italian stuff at all. I couldn't do it. I am so New York when it comes to that.
Yes, I definitely do. And I'll give Jersey credit though, because New York, New York, they got some stuff similar.
I mean, especially like the part of Jersey I'm from, you know. Like my town in Westfield, most of the people in Westfield worked in New York. So like we had New York vibes throughout. And so, yeah, I mean, the food, the cuisine is very similar to the city. And, you know, so yeah, Jersey gets props, and Connecticut gets props too, because it bleeds into Connecticut.
See, right. But the thing is, I've never been everywhere in Connecticut, well, so I don't know too much about Connecticut.
I can only speak to like Westchester area. Mm-hmm. I don't know what happens beyond Westchester, okay. Honestly. I don't have any idea. I mean, years ago, I looked at UConn as a college, but that was like the farthest I went into the state, I think. And then we used to drive through Connecticut, which seemed like it took like 40 days and 40 nights to drive through Connecticut when we used to go to Cape Cod on vacation. Because as kids, it was like the longest state to drive through. And I remember that about it.
I've heard that. Like, yeah, I've heard.
Because my parents used to drug us with Dramamine without us knowing. Like, they would give us Dramamine and our orange juice in the morning. And my sister and I, for years, didn't know why we were so sleepy in the car. And then, but it would take us, we would be asleep until we were like halfway through Connecticut. And we used to have these suction cup pillows that could go on the back windows. In the back seat, and we would put our heads down and we'd be knocked out. But yeah. But that's what I remember about Connecticut.
Wow.
I think Connecticut has some decent New York flavor too, you know, depending on where you go in the state. But I can only speak to Westchester. I know Westchester does, because we had a hotel in Westchester and they had good stuff around there. So I can say definitively that Westchester knows what's up. But I can't say about anyone else.
See, like I've been to Stanford, Connecticut, but that's only because, okay, like, for those who know me very well, I'm a very wrestling fanatic, and WWE headquarters is in Stanford, so I've actually seen the glass Titan Tower there. I was like, oh god, mm-hmm. It's not as big as they make it look. And then when I saw it from up, I was like, oh, it's not even that tall. The way they made it look, yeah, in like their videos, I'm like, wait, it's not even a tall building, but it's so long. It's all made out of glass. And I was like, okay, this was it. Okay, I'm out of here. Like, I don't know. I just found it to be weird. But definitely, like, where I'm at, I'm in Bayonne. And it's interesting because it's suburban, right? But then there's a little bit of city life there. So some aspects somewhat reminds me of New York, but not really. But when it comes to Italian food, and for anyone that's listening, if you're from anywhere in New Jersey, I definitely recommend check out Pizza Masters and San Vito's. They have the best of the best Italian food you could ever have, because they look like a pizza shop, but then when you go in, it's like, oh snap, it's a restaurant. Holy
those
crap.
Are the real, like, those insane. Are the real deals. And it's and so we have good. Real bagels in New Jersey and New York too. Because I was horrified. I went to college down in Virginia at James Madison, and my sister went to college in Virginia too. And she was at law school at Richmond at the same time I was at JMU. And before we left for school, each one of us took a dozen bagels back with us. And we would stick them in the freezer as soon as we got back to school.
Oh, man.
And we would eat them gradually. And maybe they would last us through the first couple weeks of the semester, because we were in such bagel withdrawal, because in Virginia, you couldn't get bagels. And the same thing when I lived in Baltimore, Maryland, you couldn't get bagels. When I lived in Charleston, South Carolina, you really couldn't get bagels down there. And so that was another thing. When I came back to Jersey, I was like, yes, I can finally have a good bagel.
Yeah, you know
a
what?
A proper bagel. None of this Dunkin' Donut style bagel that people call a bagel. Donut bagel.
Oh,
or I don't want a bootleg bagel. Like, I want a straight up bagel. Like, don't give me a bootleg bagel and tell me it's a bagel. You know, I want a bagel. And I felt it when I was in Virginia. And then I felt it when I lived elsewhere. So those are other things, too, that you can't get outside of our area. You just can't. You can't.
This is true. This is true. And speaking of it, I love bagels. I love everything
too.
Bagel with cream cheese and bacon. Oh my god! Like, if you're in Williamsburg one day in Brooklyn, there's a spot called the Bagel Smith. Oh my god! They have every type of bagel, every type of cream cheese you can think of, but it's bagel. Like, they make it, and it's like You see, they make a fresh batch.
Oh, and when they're hot,
boom, bread,
when
they're everything.
Hot, Andy, it's forget so it. You don't have to put anything on.
Yes.
I could just eat it. And when it's hot and the smell of it, you know, I think we both need to write companion bagel poems at this point, because I'm sure the listeners are like, what are they talking about? But this is a poetry show. And they're going on about New York fudge,
yes,
and pizza and food and bagels and. I know.
You don't know the struggle
until you've lived elsewhere. And, you know, and also, like, my diet these days, I don't need any bread. But I do reserve the right to have a bagel. If there's a fresh bagel within my grasp, I will have a bagel. But yeah, it's out of my daily diet. I'm used to, eat a bagel every morning. You know, it was just what I did. But now when I have it, it's an extreme treat. And I appreciate it even more, I have to say. So
I think that's the best form of comfort food out there. I mean, I love fries, but nothing's like a bagel. And you have coffee
I know, you can't go wrong. You absolutely can't go wrong.
Oh my God, definitely. So, I know you talked about your book. So, I'm gonna read a piece from a book, right here, A Perspective to Pen, and in the anthology, there's a piece that you actually wrote. So, I'm going to read it, and then you can talk to me about this piece right here, all right? So it's called Those Silent Ones, Destined to Speak. The weight of all your unspoken words must be unbearable. Your voices deserve to be heard, and we are not stopping until they are all set free. We know that this obstacle appears insurmountable, but just remember this. Everything that is silent is destined to explode. So, once your voices have been unleashed, tell the story of who you are and what you love. Refuse to be erased.
Yes.
It matters. You matter.
Well, that was one of the poems in the introduction part of the book, because each poet, each one of us wrote a poem for Amnesty with the Amnesty theme, with human rights obviously being the theme, because that was the cause we all collectively decided that we wanted to donate towards because of the worldwide important work that they do. And this poem of mine was really speaking about all the people in the world whose voices are silenced and don't have the opportunity and the freedom that we have, and how once they are free, how they should talk as much as they can about everything, because it matters. It matters. They need to be heard. And so it's sort of a battle cry to the people who have been silenced in wherever they live.
Oh, man. No, I hear you. And it's so interesting because I feel like this country has it so easier than any other place in the world, right? And I said this to a friend of mine months ago. Like, we was just having a conversation about, you know, just general. We were walking around, and you know, I said, let me go. We went to Hoboken Beach because I saw like our spot now to hang out, because he lives upstate now, so he comes visit me from time to time. So we were just talking about our time when we used to live in New York and all this stuff. And he was saying how when he wants to go see his mother, who lives in New York as well, he came back. He was just saying, oh yeah, I was in the city, and I saw a Muslim just, you know, praying, right? And his whole thing is, damn, but we're Christians, and yet we don't even do that publicly. Like, we're so ashamed to talk about that, right? But then he said, but look how many people everywhere else don't even have that. If you go to China, they can't even worship Jesus. They have to go to these private underground churches because of being afraid to even talk about God. Like, if you have a Bible in your hand's getting chopped off. Like, that's how it is in China. And it's like, and all these other third world countries. And it's just like it's so sad because even they have a testimony.
Yeah.
And they can't even share it. You know, and I feel like one important aspect of being having this freedom is that we take it for granted sometimes.
You know, because in a lot of places, you know, the places you mentioned and even more, you're not free to express your beliefs, what you feel. You can't speak out against the government without being put into jail or worse or killed. So it's really important that we support organizations like Amnesty because they do work and they help free some of the people and help get some of their rights. And they also help people who have been imprisoned wrongly. And, you know, I mean, it's just, there's so much of it going on all over the world beyond just not having the basic rights, but people who are thrown into prison for no good reason other than just being themselves or practicing a faith or anything really that goes against what has been defined as unacceptable behavior, which in our world is a very basic thing. You know, being able to get up and go to a church is a very basic thing for us. You know, and you could go to any church you want. You know, you could be a different denomination and go. You're welcome. You know, we could walk into a mosque and be welcome here in America, you know, but in other countries, not so much, you know. And so it is sobering when you think about it.
Yes. And it's interesting too, because I remember, I remember saying that earlier too about my childhood, where I wasn't even allowed to express my emotion. Like, unfortunately, you know, and I'm not stereotyping anyone, but I can say, for not all the time, but the majority of the times, especially like if you're my age, you know, the cultural Hispanic of a certain time, your emotions were not really allowed, because for whatever they were going through, like our parents went through things that they weren't even allowed to talk about. And then for us to try to explain this to our parents, it's like, because my father was not open at all. Like, he was very private. That's just what it was. My mom was a little bit more colorful, like, but even some things she wouldn't really, like, she always sugarcoated some things because it was just whatever. And the fact that, you know, I wasn't allowed to express, like, my emotions were not allowed. I wasn't allowed to express. I wasn't allowed to have a temper tantrum. Like, if I even talk back to my parents now, I mean, back then, I would have got smacked in the face. Like, that's just how I grew up. And it's interesting as time has, you know, as I got older, I got a little bit wiser and stuff like that. But it's like, wait, but now I have the freedom to talk about these things when I didn't have that freedom before. And I just hope that whoever goes through that same exact thing, if I don't know if people still go through this stuff, but it's just, I love the fact that we meet people younger than us that have that freedom, and they're using it for good. Whether you write negative stuff or not, even if it's demonic, but the fact is you're using that to some degree to express something, because I'm pretty sure at home you couldn't even express something like that. You know, I mean, I don't know if that was like that for you, but I know for me that's how it was. And the fact that I could really, wow, I could actually talk about this now because I had it so bottled in inside. Yeah, I've been to therapy. Like, I've been to psychiatric therapy. I've been hospitalized. You know, at one time in my life, I was suicidal. Now I'm not. At one point, I was, you know, and I've had some experiences where, you know, I should have been dead. I'm not. You know, I used to drink. I was an alcoholic. I used to do a lot of drugs, you know, and it was just like, and I thought my life was going to be over. I just didn't like my life anymore. But once, at least for me, when I came to the Lord, I saw a different perspective of life. I saw the beauty in life that I'm like, wow, it was there the whole time and I couldn't embrace. I missed out on that at that time, but now
that's I'm beautiful. Not missing I mean, out on it now. What a revelation. And I think it goes back to what you said before when I was talking about coming into the writing game so late. It's never too late to start your life and to live a beautiful life and to realize your own self-worth and why you're here, you know. And I think there's a lot of power in our pen because, you know, you were talking about expressing and how the younger people now are able to do that. And I'm familiar with the whole Latino culture because one of my longest relationships was with a Puerto Rican guy, and we were together a really long time. So I knew the family very, very well. And he was also brought up in a household where he couldn't express his emotions. And it was very difficult for him to go through that.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. Especially in that Puerto Rican culture, because I remember because, you know, if you tell my dad,
yeah,
oh yeah, I'm gay, hell no, like that wasn't tolerated. And I'll give you this: when my sister, my father had a fallout, and they didn't speak for 9 years, and he had a certain view of life that, unfortunately, at a certain time, okay, it's not like that anymore. Like, he wanted my sister to get married first, then have a family, walking down the aisle. But, you know, obviously that didn't happen. But it was just like he took it so wrong, and I get like, and it just caused them 9 years of just silence. But it just comes to show like that, like it's so crazy how now, you know.
Now it seems like people are having more conversation within the household than years before, and like even with Ricardo's family, his dad has come a long way, because after Ricardo came out, they had a meeting of the minds, and they became very, very close. And I don't think they really had a close bond before that. And so it was really, really nice to see that, because I know that he struggled because of that. And so I was pretty aware of that. And I was saved from that because even though I grew up in an Italian household, I mean, my dad is 100% Italian, but my dad was a sensitive guy. He was strong too. Like, he wasn't afraid to push you up against the wall if he needed to, but he also was sensitive. He wasn't afraid to cry.
Yeah. My dad was.
And so I grew up with that as an example. So I was very lucky. And he was very sensitive to what my mom wanted. And they got married in the late 1950s. And my mom always wanted to go to college. And my mom grew up in a very traditional Irish Catholic family, very conservative, where my grandfather said, well, if you want to go to college, you could be a nurse or a teacher. Or if you don't want to go to college, you can go to convent and become a nun. That's what women can do. And my mom's like, well, I don't want to do any of those things. So I'm just going to get a job and I'll take some college classes when I can afford it. And then when she met my dad, she explained to my dad, my dream is to go to college. He goes, okay. And he supported that. And very few Italian men in that era would have done that, you know. So I was really lucky to have my dad, because I didn't have the struggle that Ricardo had or that you had, you know, with not being able to express emotion and being told to man up and all this other nonsense. And when you just want to cry or you just want to scream or you want to express anything. And I was always able to express myself.
Yeah, no, I hear you on that. Like, with me, like, I had to do all that in private, because like I had an older brother, I had an older sister, but like there were like 6 to 5 years difference between each other. So like, I'm not gonna understand that. They're not gonna understand me because I'm young. They're gonna look at me like, oh, you're just a kid. But like, you know, and the way I always looked at life, and even to this day, I believe in this, is the fact that I would never, just because you're younger than me, I would never look at you like, oh, there's no way you can teach me about things. I've had people younger than me that taught me things.
You know, like, and you know, speaking of this anthology, Perspective to Pen, our youngest poet is only 18 years old, and he and I have been friends since he was 16. And I look at him as a peer. He's a writing peer. You know, he's an even better writer than I am. And he's 18 years old. I mean, it's crazy.
Oh, wow.
The wisdom coming from the young pens, you know, coming out of the young pens. And so I think age is a non-issue when it comes to art, because I don't think age has anything to do with it.
I agree.
They can say, oh, well, you know, I am older, so I've had more experience. And maybe that is true. I've had more life experience, but I don't underestimate any of the young writers, because they have a view of the world now that is unlike any other. And some of my favorite poets are young. You know, one of my favorite poetry books that I purchased over the last couple months is from a young poet who lives in Lebanon. And I think he was 16 years old when he published this book. And he's a little older now. I think he might be around 20 years old. I don't even know. I need to ask him, because we're supposed to do an Instagram Live together at some point soon. And I can't wait for that, because I'm such a huge fan of his, like, gigantic fan. I think he's such a talented writer. So, you know, you just never know. And so I don't even look at age when it comes to art and when it comes to poetry and writing, because it doesn't mean a damn thing as far as I'm concerned.
Amen. Amen. No, I definitely agree with that. Sure.
I'll go back to one more piece anthology, or maybe I'll read something brand new. How about that? This is from my journal, and it's called Disappearing Into You. And here it is. We step outside as David Bowie's Let's Dance blares through the speakers, drowning out the sounds of the city. It is raining lightly, and we huddle under the entrance of Rebecca's apartment building. You prop an elbow against the arched wooden door. I watch you run your hand through your perfect messy hair. The overhead light illuminates you like an Italian museum exhibit. To these eyes, you are the New York version of the statue David. You take out a lighter and flick it no fewer than a dozen times before it catches a flame. You light your joint and shoot me a look that should scare me more than it does. The idea of a tryst with no permanence is a new approach for me, but I have a desire that needs to be satiated. I am drunk and my eyes are slightly out of focus, but I see that desire lives in your shadow light. It penetrates the corner of my consciousness, spilling onto the pavement where you stand. The silence hangs between us as you skillfully level me with your eyes. Your touch eases onto my flesh. It is surprisingly soft and balanced, rippling like waves in my veins as I disappear into you.
Wow, I like that. What inspired that piece?
Well, it was 1980s and it was New York. And I was young, you know, and it's funny because this situation, I've always been a long-term relationship guy. Like, I've never done like the one night stand thing except for this.
Me either.
And I remember being on the train on the way home and being, I remember feeling like, almost like a drug addict who just got their fix and is coming down off the high, because that's how low I felt. I felt so empty. I felt like it was absent and void of any love. And it was just the act itself. And it wasn't anything more than that. And it left me feeling disappointed and just hollow. And I didn't like that feeling. And I had this revelation when I was relatively young. I was in my 20s. And I decided I was never going to do that again. I never did.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
That's
so
deep, man.
So it was, you know, it was one of these parties. And it was actually in Brooklyn, because Rebecca lived in Brooklyn. And it was at her house, her apartment, this party. And it was late. And yeah, and it happened, and I remember thinking, I don't ever want to be put in this situation again, you know, and I'm doing myself a disservice, and that's not the way I love, because I love really hard. And
yeah, I'm the same way, brother, trust me, I know what you mean.
Yeah, so it's like, that's the only kind of love I really understand, and I can't have it any other way, so I'm an all-or-nothing guy. I'm either all-in or all-out.
No, I hear you. Yeah. I definitely hear you on that. It's true, because, you know, like, I can't just like, for example, like, I've had women, you know, like in college, like, that wanted to have sex with me, but I'm the kind of guy like in order for me to do that, like, you would have to be like my girlfriend or something like that. Because, you know, one thing I've learned, you don't know what kind of energy you're feeding your soul. You know,
no.
There's like
all
these things that people don't understand that. That's why, like, because I used to be addicted to pornography before I came to the Lord. And I look back now, I'm like, damn, but people just give it out just like that? Like, really?
Yeah.
But it's like, I'm thinking in my head, like, do they go through things? Like, it's just like, I don't understand. Like, it's so crazy. And let's put it this way. They do a lot of, like, disgusting things. I'm just like, oh, my God, I used to watch this crap. Like, oh, my God. And they just give it out so freely. Like it's like, there's no way. This can't be just normal like that. It's crazy to me.
Well, I think,
because again, like,
I think it's important for everyone to realize how things affect us, how things affect you personally. And that's what you pay attention to. Like, I always say, your gut is right. Follow your gut instinct. And my gut was screaming, like, this is not right for you. This is not for you. So I think everyone's gut is slightly different. That's why you see people doing different things. But your gut obviously was telling you something very similar too. Like, I can't carry on like this. This isn't right for me. And even the way that you conducted yourself, with dating and committing to somebody before you would cross that threshold, I think it just is a matter of how it makes us feel. And I just remember feeling like, this is something that I don't ever want to feel again.
No, I hear you on that. And I remember, like, even whether it was that or if I did drugs or whatever, like, I know when you said that hollow feeling, like, I felt empty. I felt dirty. Yeah. Like, I felt like I was just a piece of wrapper on the floor that people just step all over, and I just didn't care. Like, I didn't feel anything because you step on paper, that paper doesn't feel nothing.
Yeah.
It's just a piece of paper that came from a tree that probably had life. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm getting all crazy here, but it's just, that hollowed feeling. Mm. Like, it's not an easy feeling to overcome. I'm not saying it's not possible. It's just difficult, you know? And it's hard. It's hard, man.
And it was the only time I was ever with somebody I didn't kiss.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. And so that to me was like, really strange. The whole thing was strange, but again, I'm thankful for the experience though, because it taught me a lot. It taught me a lot.
Yes.
It taught me a lot. And so I look at that, and that was a great thing because I think it saved me from making some bad decisions later in life. And I'll never forget that one. And I finally wrote about it. All these years later,
that's awesome.
I finally wrote about it. I don't know why I wrote about it the other day. I don't really know why. I mean, that was a great David Bowie song. Let's Dance was a great song and was all over the city in the 80s.
Yes.
All over the city.
Oh, man. David Bowie's.
That
man.
Was the vibe. That was the vibe. Yeah. That was the vibe of the 80s. Like David Bowie, that record, the Let's Dance. I remember in college, my roommate got a brand new stereo just so he could blast that song.
Nice.
Just so he could blast that song at a keg party. He got, I can't remember that.
Nah. Who has keg parties anymore?
Like we used to have those, I lived off campus after my sophomore year, and we lived like literally one street off campus, but we were still off campus. It was called University Court. That was the nickname of the street because it was all university kids living in these townhouses. But we had a pool and you weren't allowed to have beer in the pool. So we used to roll the keg on the other side of the fence. And then you would just lean over the fence and grab your beer from the keg.
Oh, my goodness. That's funny, but it's so awesome at the same time. Like, oh, my God.
And we were safe. We were safe. We weren't having glass or anything. We all had like the red cups, red and yellow cups.
Oh my god, yeah.
so we were safe by the pool. We kept the guy on one another. We were relatively fun.
Threw it. It made sense. It made sense. Why not? Let's who are we kidding, right? Oh my god, man. But Robert, thank you so much
for
doing the episode with me. So I want to wrap it up here. Do you have any final words, any final thoughts?
Well, anyone out there, when you grab a Perspective to pen, it's also a donation to Amnesty. So remember that. It's a great gift to give somebody. And it's available everywhere. 11 other poets from Instagram in here. And we're from America, the Netherlands, the UK, and here in America. I said it already. I guess I said that already. We range in age from 18 to my age. So you get a lot of different perspectives in here. And I just want to thank you again for having me on. It was great to talk to you. It was great to reminisce about New York. I miss the city so much. I can't wait until I can get back in there.
Hopefully this pandemic, once it's over, the vaccines and stuff like that. I mean, I don't know. I'm still iffy about it. I'm just waiting. Yeah. When I hear good stuff about it, then maybe I'll take the vaccine. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. We'll see. But I hope that everything comes back soon. You know, I have.
But let's be honest. But I don't think it's gonna come back the way exactly no. how it was. It'll be a new type of normal. Like, even if we no longer wear the mask, but you know, I feel like paranoia is gonna be a big time higher.
I think so. And things will open, but it'll be gradual. It'll be and I think a lot of the new policies and new behaviors will be implemented. And abide it you know, and people will follow them because they don't want to take a step back. And I think it'll just be different. I'm not sure we'll ever see a New York New Year's Eve in Times Square like we were accustomed to ever again with people on top of one another. I don't know if we'll ever see that again.
Yeah, it's crazy though, but I think to me this was definitely a blessing because I got to see a different perspective, you know, of the world, and you know I saw it from a different eye. I guess you can say, you know, and it's taught me so much about myself personally.
Oh, me too.
You know?
I mean, I realized the other big revelation I'll leave you with is I realized that when I meet somebody, I don't introduce myself that I'm a hotel manager. I tell them I'm a writer. Because I realized that this year, that that's what defines me, that I spent my life doing what I love second best. You know,
Amen.
So that's,
Amen, brother.
That's a big thing that happened this year, is that I lead with that now because I was given this gift of time and I've done some of my best writing this year. And so I'll never, ever look at that the same way. And I'm so thankful for that, even amid this pandemic and everything else, that I'm very thankful that I got to realize that, because I don't know if I ever would have realized that if not for 2020.
Oh my God. And that's beautiful, man. That's such a beautiful thing. And I agree with you on that as well. Even from my life, I definitely agree with you on that, man, because it helped me appreciate my life more than ever in this entire life existence, you know? So definitely. So brother, thank you so much for
doing this
episode with me. Thank you so much for your love, you know, for your heart,
you
man. And may the Lord continue to bless you and just keep you safe, man. And we should definitely do one of these again soon, man.
Yes, definitely. Because this was one of the most enjoyable podcasts I've ever been on, and I've been on a bunch. So this was like talking to an old friend, and a a like mind, which is quite pleasant, you know, because we both share a lot of the same passions. So that definitely helps things along.
No, thank you so much, brother. So God bless. And everybody, thank you for listening. And we'll see you soon for episode 3.